Great, well, I'm on. Fantastic, welcome back, everybody. It's a sudden softy here. So I'd like to spend half an hour going through this document, which was co-produced with ourselves, Yorkshire Water and other colleagues, funded by the Foundation, just some of the aspects that are in here. So it's useful to sort of, I think, reflect, having heard David talk about implementation in Yorkshire Water, where we are with risk governance. And you understand now where we're using the word governance, because the organisational and people aspects are critical. So hopefully you'll get a sense that this really does generate value. This isn't just a tick box exercise. This isn't just a paper-based exercise. There's genuine value for organisations here, not only in terms of making sound decisions, but also being perceived as trusted partners by their stakeholders. The culture is critical, and one of the things that David has mentioned, is in relation to taking responsibility. You know, risks don't get managed unless individuals do stuff. And, you know, there's a whole business around doing risk assessments, risk analyses for organisations. But unless those are translated into actual doable actions, then risks don't get managed. And so the people thing, the people side of it, which this document places a lot of emphasis on, is critical. I'm going to talk in a moment about some of the aspects that relate to systemic risk. We use multiple barriers to protect customers from hazardous agents in water. So we have treatment processes, we have training, both physical and soft barriers, training, competent staff, etc. All these barriers are there deliberately to ensure that by the time water gets to the tap, it's safe to drink. And so it's quite interesting that we use these barriers to manage risk. And all of those barriers, I would argue, have some flaws within them. And we can see by looking at some of the high-profile water quality incidents that have occurred over the years, how the gestation of an incident actually develops. And sometimes that can take years, decades of flaws. So it's quite useful to think about our systems in that way, rather than just in a sort of single sort of deterministic way. But all systems, and, you know, of course, all that work that was done on the Challenger disaster and all of that historically by NASA and the experts that looked at all of that to show how systemic failure can build up over time in every system. That research has been done largely by occupational psychologists. Is of tremendous value to our sector because we're so used to using the multi-barrier approach, which is central to how we protect customers. So we've been lucky to work with a number of boards, not only in the water sector, but in offshore oil and gas, in energy, etc., power generation. And, of course, while you've got some great champions for risk on boards, there's also an element to which they can find a lot of this stuff very, very dry and voluminous. You know, really thick risk reports. And one of the challenges for risk managers is to condense it and make it live and a bit more exciting and accessible and readable, and so that people can engage with it, particularly the executive. Often the discussion of the risk register, if you like, for an organisation, gets 15 minutes airtime in an agenda with 20 minutes, you know, 20 items on it. So it doesn't always get the attention it could deserve, and so there's a real communications challenge. The requirement on boards then is to sort of obviously to articulate the risk appetite. So if you're in the business, you can feel empowered as to know how much risk to take. And finally, the whole issue about information, data, knowledge, evidence. These aren't all the same things. So, you know, we all know that data is essential. But what do you actually use to make a well-founded decision about risk management? So two aspects about risk, which we're very familiar with. Can I have the next? There we go. Yes. You know, it's a whole thing about asset management and condition assessment, et cetera, et cetera. This is your world and the world of many utilities, of course, predicting remaining useful life and residual life. And our residual risk that I drew up earlier comes into play, of course. When it comes to the sort of threshold, really, by which you consider the criticality of an asset or a set of assets. So the point at which, if this is the condition threshold, a bit above which you may be acting, then this actually is representing the level of residual risk you're willing to tolerate. And so again, it's all about how this is communicated within the business, because although all the condition assessments and all that is going on all the time, this criticality threshold becomes a key determinant of when you act, when you invest, when you refurbish, etc. So I'm just trying to show how the residual risk here and the need to be able to discuss it plays itself out in reality in asset management. Of course, there's a world of difference between the, as we all know, between the projected performance of an asset and the observed over time. And I don't want to spend some time on the on this model, because are people familiar with it? I mean, it's on the front of your your handout. Is it? Okay, so it's called the Swiss cheese model, unsurprisingly. The Swiss cheese model. And it was developed by an occupational psychologist, a chap called James Reason, who worked a lot with the aviation sector. And he became interested in how aviation accidents actually occurred, or near misses occurred. And so he worked very, very closely with that sector to try and reveal the root causes of accidents. And like many systems and like many industries, you can perceive the way in which we prevent bad things happening is by putting a series of barriers in place. Now, those barriers might be tangible, physical barriers like bits of treatment works, treatment process, engineering, etc. They could be things like training. It could be things like the value system that we have in place so that good behaviours are apparent in the business. And the way he describes failure, of course, what is in relation to the flaws that exist in these layers. His argument is that every barrier that we have in our systems is flawed. Every barrier, to a certain extent. And he makes a very powerful argument to say, well, most of the time we're not actually seeing the true incident or the true accident. The accident only occurs when all the holes line up, as you can see in the schematic. But most of the time, one or two or three barriers are preventing, yeah, they're preventing the accident actually occurring because we've got multiple barriers in place. He then develops the argument and therefore says, well, actually then, a lot of the time, we're not actually seeing the latent failure, the degree of failure that's building up in our organisations. And stuff could be building up over time, therefore, that we're not aware of because we don't see the ultimate incident. And this is quite important in terms of systemic failure, particularly if we start to strip cost out of organisations. We can become failure tolerant to the point where little small failures are occurring, but they don't ever result in a large incident. So this is his philosophy, is that over time, risk can actually build up in an organisation. And therefore, you have to be really careful about what you actually tolerate. So we've got good examples of this, and we've got one particular example that you may be aware of is the fatal Walkerton outbreak in Ontario. It's been a well-publicised incident in the water sector. I'm sure you're aware of, I know there's been articles in Opflow, etc., on Walkerton. And it's an important example because of a series of flaws in the barriers, but also the gestation period between when a shallow groundwater well was produced for the town and when the incident occurred 12 years later. So it demonstrates the amount of time that it can take to build up to an actual incident and a series of sort of flaws that took place, both in terms of the original well design, right the way through to when that well became overwhelmed by a very high rainfall event, an agricultural runoff got into the shallow groundwater supply and was eventually supplied to the town that was without a chlorine residual. I would encourage colleagues to read the article in Opflow of 2 or 3 years ago. So all systems are like this, and this is important to us because when we think about preventative risk management, it means if we're really serious about it, we've got to go off into our organisations, closing these holes in the cheese, blocking them off. And of course, you can see the paradox now, because if unless you've got this hole exposed, if you haven't got, imagine that's blocked, and you're actually trying to make a case for process improvement or improving the business in terms of addressing these flaws, it's quite a difficult case to make to your finance director, for the investment in that preventative risk management, when there's no actual obvious final failure in being seen. But this is, I think, the reality of preventing risk in a proactive way, is that we have to go through our organisations and we have to decide how many of these holes we're going to address, which ones we're going to address, and we're going to have to target resources accordingly.